Hi, I'm Peter Lowe, and I've been running an ad and tracker block list for the past 28 years, which is from about 1997. It's basically a collection of domains which are primarily used for tracking or ads on the internet. That's pretty much it.
You cited today in your talk that you believe you're the first person to do this. So what kind of inspired the idea at first?
The story is that a long time ago, I was playing around with a local DNS server. And with a local DNS server, you can configure it to be the master for, like, authoritative for any domain you like. And it will answer as if it was the owner of that domain, authoritative for that domain. And I realized that you could get it to be authoritative for, like, doubleclick.net. And then essentially, any requests that were going out from your browser, if they were using that DNS server, you could configure it so that doubleclick.net didn't exist or returned localhost for every query. And I thought I was very clever and decided to put my list of domains on the internet, and I started collecting them, and there was a couple of hundred to start off with. And then I found other people doing the same thing with hosts files, which are sort of, I don't know if you know are familiar with host files, but it's like a local lookup for domains that happens on the device. And yeah, I just carried on doing it. That's the story, really.
Yeah, it's funny because you said hi to me earlier, and like once you said your name, because I see, you know, you see it in NextDNS, AdGuard. It's like always just an available list, uBlock origin. So yeah. How's it kind of been to see what you originally took and to just see it be so prolific and kind of a de facto
tool? I mean, it's been great. It's the one thing I do that I think is unambiguously kind of good for the internet. I'm not making any money. I get a few Patreon donations, $150 a month, I think, in total, something like that, 180. But yeah, no, I don't advertise that. I don't ask for donations, really. And it's good. It's nice. It's a nice, warm feeling, you know? A lot of other people do things a lot better than I do. We put a lot more effort in. But I will say that my list is mine. And every entry I've added, and I've reviewed every entry, I'm quite proud of the list's integrity. So, yeah.
So is that the difference between yours? Because there's, you know, there's Easy List, there's AdGuard's list. And so what are people getting when they opt into using the Peter Lowe list?
My specific policy, which I think differs between different block lists. So EasyList has its own policy. They try and, try and balance usability versus, you know, what they're actually blocking. uBlock Origin in particular adds unbreak rules for a lot of entries from my list. If you go to the stats, the filter list stats, you'll see it's using 2,500 of 3,000 entries from my list or something like that. Because some of the rules that I've got in there break. Break things. But yes, I have a very clean list as well. There's very, very few dead entries or false positives, that kind of thing. But it's relatively small. I'm not trying to cover the whole internet. But yes, I think there's the integrity and the cleanliness of the list are two things. And my specific policy, which is any domain which is primarily being used for as an ad or a server or a tracker.
Got it. And final thing, why? What inspires you to do it? Is it privacy? Is it just you don't like ads?
That was the original motivation. I didn't like ads, and I realized that by blocking some of the, you know, the ad domains, it made it cleaner to browse and faster as well, because you completely block any of the hundreds of network requests.
And
that
more efficient, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But then actually, as it kind of went on, I call myself a closet privacy evangelist. Mm-hmm. Because there's probably more entries on the list now for trackers than there are for ads. And over time, 27 years, I've kind of learned about what stuff is being tracked and where it's being tracked and how it's being used. And it's quite horrible, I think, really, and weird. So, yeah, I think that's probably the biggest purpose now. And I would say that I'm, you know, learned so much about privacy in the meantime.
Yeah. Do you have a quick example for somebody who might not understand how they're tracked? Because all this happens but behind the scenes. So do you have an interesting example to share for someone who might go, what's going on?
The classic example is the girl who shopped at, I think it was Target. And she was shopping online, and then one day I think she got some free nappies or something like that. I think it was like free food or free baby food or something that basically indicated that she was pregnant. And I can't remember the exact details, but I think her dad found it, Target knew before she was that she was pregnant because of her shopping habits had changed and she hadn't disclosed it or anything. And it's kind of scary. The other way I think about it is you get offered stuff on sites based on your user behavior on another site. And I think limited tracking is okay in that, let's say, if I go to my local convenience store and I go there every day, and then one day I go there and they've got my newspaper and pint of milk ready for me, you know, that's fine. That's like the guy behind the counter is getting to know me and kind of offering me a bit of convenience. But if I go to the US and go into a convenience store there and somebody offers me a pint of milk and a newspaper, that's weird and creepy. And that's the kind of tracking that's going on.
Yeah, very well said.
Yeah, so.
Cool, well, thank you so much.